Hello, welcome to Nila Folklore Film Festival. We meet again, and today we are in conversation with Sumar Joshan,
Trying
whose
to
film,
get in. The link
Niyam
is
Kari.
this, but it's not going. I'll write in. How do you start now? Okay? Maybe you start.
Sorry, yeah. So today we have with us Sumar Joshan, whose film Niyam Kari, You Are Still Alive, is part of the Panorama section. After completing her graduation from the University of Minnesota in English Literature, she began her career as a journalist, but later on switched over to visual media. She has directed and written screenplays for two Malayalam feature films, Janmadinam and Sadi, and has to her credit documentaries that deal with political, agricultural, and developmental issues, and has authored three books, A Harvest of Light, which is a collection of plays, a novel titled Circumferences and Poems and Plays. The film on anti-bauxite mining campaign in Orissa, led by the indigenous communities against Sterlite, a subsidiary of the UK mining company Vedanta, is a film that throws light on the situations that existed at the time of the mining events. We are grateful to have you with us, Suma. To host the event, we have with us Gangadharan Menon, a teacher, travel writer, photographer, and documentary filmmaker who has graciously accepted our invitation to associate with IFFI. Professor Gangadharan, who has worked in the field of advertising for almost three decades, is now engaged as a teacher at the Viva Institute of Applied Art. Gangadharan, along with K.K. Chandran, made a movie on Silent Valley, a pristine evergreen forest located in the Nilgiri Hills that houses several precious flora and fauna near Palakkad district of Kerala. Armed with a 16mm camera and bags filled with the bare necessities required for survival in the valley, the small team marched forward to the dam site through dense, pathless forests. And braving great opposition from the dam lobby, the film was made and released, and that resulted in the halting of the construction of the dam. And that park, that area, that forest being declared a protected national park. Gangadharanji, thank you for accepting our invitation. Over to you guys. Mr. Menon, you may take the stage.
Yeah. Hi, Suma.
Hi, Ganga. Yeah.
Yeah, meeting Suma after a long time. The pandemic, we haven't met.
Yeah.
The first time we met, Suma and I, was I think in 1999, when she was making her second film, Sari. By then, she had moved from journalism to the visual media, and she had started making feature films. The first thing I want to know from Suma is, what made you move from journalism to the visual media?
Yeah, you know, actually, I started off as a poet, a writer, and most of my poetry is very image-based. In the same time, I was also interested in films. So I was watching a lot of films. I mean, I don't have any kind of formal training in filmmaking. Everything is being picked up on the job. So this whole, my writing, which was image-based, my poetry, which was image-based, you know, so that is what sort of translated into the visual medium. It was very visual. My writing was very visual. So that sort of, I think, automatically got translated. Yeah.
Okay. And after making Janmadinam and Sari, you moved on to a completely different genre, which is documentary filmmaking, and you kind of stayed there. Okay, so I would like to know, do you see a documentary filmmaking as a more powerful and purposeful kind of films? Why did you move again from feature film to documentary?
Yeah, I should just make a small correction there, Ganga. The thing is that I first started as a journalist and as a poet journalist, and then I moved on to television, and then I was making documentary films.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, because in the television companies that I worked with, you know, PTI TV and TVI, I was making documentary films. And okay. then I moved on to feature, and then again I moved on to documentary films. So it was a kind of a process. Also because I felt, as a filmmaker, I felt, that I need to show the real facts which are happening, you know. So which is why I moved on to, basically I'll call myself an activist filmmaker, you know, but trying to make it as aesthetic as possible and trying to make it as simple and communicating as, you know, communicative as possible. Yeah.
If you take a look at the documentaries that you have made, you know, In Search of the Lost Seeds, or, you know, Report You Sow, The Seed Man, they are all related, right up to Niyamgiri, they are all connected with the soil, okay? Mm-hmm. Something to do with the children of the soil. So what makes you drawn towards that subject as an umbrella subject?
Yeah, I mean, that's an extremely very good point that you've touched, because the soil, I mean, you know, if you go to see the film, Niyamgiri film, constantly they mention about the earth, you know, that's what they just think, you know. And for me, the soil is so important because due to this, of course, in agriculture, due to green revolution, the whole chemical, ways of agriculture, the usage of chemicals, the soil is completely gone. And we actually come from the soil. If you take the microbes in us and if you take the microbes in the soil, we are the same. You know, there's not much difference. So once the soil is gone, our health is gone, everything is gone. So everything is so interconnected, you know. So which is why, in fact, I want to make a film on soil. And then, you know, I've been wanting to do it. I mean, there are films that have been made on soil. But I think the soil is a basic unit of life. Soil, water, and, you know, these elements. And once you destroy them, it's gone. I mean, so that's what it is.
Once you told me, I remember you had made two films on Niyamgiri at two different points in time.
Right.
And the current film, Niyamgiri, You Are Still Alive, is a kind of amalgamation of the two films that you made.
Right.
How were they different? And at those points in time, how was right. Niyamgiri different? And any stories that you would like to share?
Yeah, so the first time I made, the first film I made, I went to Niyamgiri in 2007. This was immediately after the refinery started functioning and working. And the second film, I think I went in 2009 or so. So basically the first film was you know, the lands of the tribals were taken away, that biodiversity was getting destroyed, the water was getting contaminated, and the various issues connected with mining and displacing these tribals and forest dwellers from their land. So that was the first film all about. The second film was on this big ritual, which the Dongra cones and Kutia cones, which the basic Adivasi groups which are there in Niyamgiri. Niyamgiri, by the way, is in Raigad district in Orissa. So they were having this big function. You know, it's like a puja, but then, you know, it was, I would rather call it a kind of a ritual, where the chief priest would get himself, you know, the Devi and Niyamgiri, the god, would enter the person, enter the chief priest, and then the god would say that whether mining is going to take place or not. So that was the whole ritual about. But it is also, you know, it's very raw sort of a ritual, which is there in the film.
Yeah.
You know, parts of it is in the film. And finally, the high priest said that there will not be any mining in Niyamgiri. You know, that was the answer which he came up with. This was before any decision was taken. Okay. So the third film, which I put together, was on the environmental issues, purely on the environmental issues, the loss of the biodiversity, the animal population, and the ecosystems. And so the third film is at water. Water getting contaminated. So this was the third film. So the first time when I went, there was a lot of the stories which you are telling me. First time when I went, the cameraman and I, we were just turning around in circles because we didn't know where to put the camera. So usually I tell the cameraman, you know, put the camera here and let's take a shot there. So then I asked him, you know, Tapan, where do we put the camera? So then he said, that's what I also feel. I don't know where to put the camera, you know, because it's such a beautiful place, you know, the whole this thing. So and then to imagine that this is going to be completely destroyed with bauxite mining is something which is tragic. Also, now there are two issues here. One is bauxite mining, which in 2010, which the government, the UPA government said no. And that was again based on the Forest Rights Act of 2006. And the second is the construction of the refinery, for which no environmental clearance was taken. And the people who were staying there, they were evicted with violence. And you know, some of them were taken to Bhubaneswar. They said, let's go for a picnic to Bhubaneswar. So they were all taken to Bhubaneswar. And when they came back, their houses were all flat. So this is the way the refinery was built. Do you want to ask me anything on this? I mean, because I could go on, you know, like, so the first time we went, you know, there were all these gundas on motorbikes. So we had to be extremely careful. We were very low key. And at several times we felt that, you know, we were being followed by these people, because the first thing they'll do is they'll just take the camera and break it, you know? So I have faced these problems. You know, I always make films on people's struggles, you know, so I face this problem. So I know exactly how to protect my footage. So it's automatically, then immediately I told the cameraman, do this. And then, and unfortunately, you know, we were safe. So we couldn't take, you know, shots of the refinery from very close quarters. So we had to go at very far distance and from there film the refinery. And even after going through these long distances, we had security guards coming in, you know, telling us get away from there. So we operated on this whole, this thing of fear the first time. The second time it was much better. You know, we were able to move around freely. Yeah.
Okay. One thing that struck me when I saw the film, and especially that footage that you're talking about of the ritual, most of their gods or whatever forms or idols, they reminded you of the totem poles, you know?
Absolutely.
So there is a beautiful connection between the aborigines all over the world and Absolutely. Our own Adivasis. There is a common, I have a feeling, common ancestry, because they're very, very totem-like. That was what I wanted to ask you. You also felt that, okay. The other thing I wanted to know is you talked about the risk. Now, with the current dispensation, with the Adanis and the Ambanis given a free run, and they, you know, along with the timber mafia and the mining mafia, they can do, I mean, do you think a Niyamgiri, the film you made, the last film, is it possible to make it today? Would they allow you at all?
See, it is not, one is, it's a question of allowing, that is the one thing. So, okay, by hook or crook, you make the film, you know, somehow you make the film, you get it done. But then the whole question of Niyamgiri is a success story. Although the refinery is there and that is harming people. And so a lot of the people whom I spoke to in the film have all moved out of that place because they were not able to live. So that is kind of, the toxins are coming and, you know, that is poisoning. But the other side of it is mining is not allowed. So that's a great, great relief. Okay, so now you're asking me whether such a success story can happen. The chances are very, very low. Because if you look at the Forest Rights Act, you know, Forest Rights Act of 1927, which was passed by the British. So there, of course, the tribals and the forest dwellers were not given any kind of rights to access the forest. And they were just basically treated like criminals, you know. And then came the 2006 under UPA, which starts off by saying that the Adivasis, the tribals, and the forest dwellers are the natural inheritors of the forest. And so it was beneficial to the forest dwellers and tribals. And it also mentioned it sort of strengthened the Gram Sabhas, which is why in Niyamgiri, in the Supreme Court, I think in 2013, said that you know, the Gram Sabhas in Niyamgiri should take a decision. So you know, the Vedanta tried to, you know, pull them with, give them money and bribe them and that and this, but it didn't succeed. All 12 Gram Sabhas said no to mining. So, but today, 2019, we have a draft of the Forest Rights Act, okay, which worse than the colonial times. The Adivasis tribals have no rights. If they take anything from the forest, it is considered illegal. They can be imprisoned. The Gram Sabhas have no rights. It's going to go to the forest officials. The forest officials have an immunity, legal immunity. They cannot be arrested. You know, it's just like in the farm laws. The farm laws, the farmers cannot go to a court. So, yeah. You know, it's like in every way, they are being it's like a wall that is being built around. So films can be made, you know. You go there, you swim rivers and you make films, you know, that's a different thing. But the point is that, will it see? I mean, you have such a draconian law, I mean, this the draft which is there. And today, by the way, earlier, the government had said that the private parties could also give their opinion. We all know that they're consulting the private parties, the Adanis and Ambanis and all of them. But today that is being withdrawn. I mean, you know, it's just a showcase, right? So it's like on one hand, you talk about climate change and you talk about the floods and, you know, all that is all the things that are happening with climate change. On the other hand, you have governments who are utterly, utterly, you know, blind to what is happening. I know, and that is a tragedy of what is happening in India today in every front.
And people who actually fought for their rights, like Father Stan Swami or, you know, Sudha Bharadwaj, they are being hounded for doing what is naturally to be done, you know, protecting their rights.
So right, absolutely.
That is when I feel, you know, how beautifully your film and Niyamgiri is connected to folklore. Actually, they have very interesting folklore about the entire mountain. So the mountain Niyam actually is a law in Malayalam also. Giri is a mountain. So that mountain is the giver of laws. And right. That mountain is the father and the mother. And they are saying, if we forsake our father and mother, the earth will swallow us. I mean, it is there in your film. So
right.
That is the kind of folklore that needs to be built to save environment. I find there is a beautiful connection between mythology or legend or idiom or folklore and conservation. There is a beautiful connect. I would like to talk about how these belief systems are very important.
Yeah, so I mean, I have traveled around quite a bit. MP, I have traveled to so many villages, worked with, it was for a book basically, spoken to the tribals. And so for me, it was like, going to Niyamgiri reinstated what I already knew, the kind of wisdom that they have, you know, which we had earlier, which was completely gone, which, you know, our brains are taken over by junk food and, you know, so the microbes have all gone. So you go there and they come out with astounding words of wisdom, you know, and like, you know, I just listened to them. Of course, I didn't know the language initially, but, you know, when I started talking to them and with the, you know, little bit of Sanskrit here and then I was able to put it together, I was like astounded and I was shocked to hear what they said. I mean, just like the lines which you mentioned, which is what is going to happen. If you take away Niyamgiri, it is going to eat us up. If you're going to destroy the ecological systems, we are going to be eaten up. We're going to be destroyed. The planet is going to disappear. So these are all things. And Ganga, the thing is that the kind of agility and the movement and, you know, it's all a part of that. And then they come up with their own stories, you know, like in the film, they say that now when we go up to Niyamgiri, you know, the bears and everybody, you know, all the wild animals, they go their own way and we go come around. So there is a kind of innocence about the whole thing, you know, and which is what is so essential to mention, I mean, to sustain.
True. So So another question which is the difference between a feature film and a documentary. A feature film has a closure, you know, it has an end. But a documentary like Niyamgiri will never have an end. It's an ongoing struggle. So would you like to keep coming back to a subject which is very close to your heart? Because it's never, never ending.
Absolutely. That's although my feature film Janmadinam didn't have an end, actually, one could just take it forward. Anyway, so no, but then what you said is correct. See, like even today, if Anil Agarwal, Vedanta, if they start applying and if they start doing, and you know, even today we don't know whether the mining thing will be overturned. Although now Adani and Vedanta, they keep saying that, you know, there are only 88 million tons of bauxite in Niyamgiri, whereas there's 700 million tons of bauxite in Orissa. And India is the third largest bauxite producing country. Okay, so it's like he's very happy. And you have this very good, you know, the Orissa government has been, you know, giving everything to the to Vedanta. So we just don't know, you know. So it is a never-ending process, and it's a constant struggle. I mean, I should also tell you this: Vedanta had opened schools, you know, small school, kindergarten schools. So in the middle of this village where I went, where the houses were all demolished, and that was a village where the whole people, they were taken to Bhubaneswar and they came back and it was all demolished. Suddenly I heard this Jack and Jill, you know, the nursery rhyme, Jack and Jill went up the hill, of course, in a very different way. So I went running, and there was in this broken down house, Vedanta runs schools for conducting, you know, kindergarten schools for these children. Okay, so this was in 2007, right? 2019, there was this huge, so they are still continuing to run these schools. So there was this huge, there was a clash between the security guards and some of the tribals. And one of the issues was, you need to decrease the fees of the schools. The irony of it all. You know, so this is what it is, you know, and this is just to kind of show the world that we are doing something. Yeah. We went to there's a hospital which is run by Vedanta. There was not a single soul there, you know, at that time. So anyway, so this is how it is. So
the other interesting thing about your title is it has a very ominous ring to it. It says, Niyamgiri, you are still alive.
Correct.
That word, I think you must have inserted to say, kabhi bhi kuch bhi ho sakta hai.
Yeah. Absolutely, Kanka. That's very correct, because even today, we don't know what's going to happen. And with the present forest rights, I don't know, you know, what is going to happen. We just don't know. It's like a kind of a you know, shock. You know, we are really being subjected to these shock treatments, and we just have to take it. You know, so that's the way everything is run. And Niyamgiri is basically like the other films which have been shown in the festival itself. It's a replica of the same thing. You know, and these people who have been evicted, they have not been provided houses. Nothing. The government has just washed their hands off. So, you know, fortunately, they are adapted to living in mountains and that and this, so which is what they've done. So now, unfortunately, the refinery is expanding with the support of the Orissa government. So at one point, they were manufacturing, they were refining about 2 million tons of bauxite. Now it is 6 million, so it has reached and they're trying to expand. They haven't expanded as yet, I think. And then what do you use this aluminium for? I mean, aluminium, you get aluminium out of bauxite. What do you use it? The arms and arms industry uses it for fighter planes, for war. Yeah. You know, that's what it is. So, you know, so it's a vicious circle. And what does bauxite do? what does bauxite do? Bauxite is the origin of rivers, because bauxite absorbs the moisture, and along with the vegetation, they hold moisture, and that small trickle develops into springs and springs into small rivers, and those rivers, you know, become bigger rivers. So this is what, for since evolution, this is what bauxite has done. You know, so we are targeting the source of water. So water is gone, the biodiversity is gone, and it's so lovely, because, you know, I went during the time when paddy was being just being planted, so it was all full paddy, and it was green and forests, and, you know, and even going to the forest was quite an adventurous task for us, because we had to climb. And I should tell you this, one of the stories, because I'm sure the viewers would be interested. So one of the persons who accompanied the team, the crew, was an Ayurvedic doctor. You know, it's like all of them are fighting, you know, all of them are fighting against Vedanta. So then I just, you know, asked him, you know, we were in a forest, in the middle of a forest. I said, what is that tree? What is that for? He said, that's for diabetes. What is that? That is for high blood pressure. So he kept on telling. So he said, this is for that, this is for that. At the end of it, I said, okay, this whole forest, you use this whole forest for medicines? He said, yes. So, which is what the tribals also have said, you know, and it's sad, because, you know, if to imagine that all that is going to be destroyed, the water is going to be destroyed.
And I particularly was touched by something that woman who was carrying a baby in her hand. She said, if you drink that water, your mouth has sores, you know. Oh God, I mean, I said, you know, drinking water from a stream, if it can cause mouth sores, how toxic it must be.
Yeah.
And in a way, it is a kind of slow poisoning of this entire tribe is what I see. They're killing them slowly. I mean, that's what I felt after I saw your film. See, this is their way of, you know, officially, legally killing them.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. That's what it is. I mean, if you take all the rehabilitation that is taking place, you know, when whether it is Narmada or any other place, you find that none of these people have been rehabilitated, you know. So fortunately, because Niyamgiri is big, and, you know, so, and these are tribals, so they're able to go somewhere and sort of this thing. But these are lands which they have been cultivating and living on for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. I mean, this is their land. And at that time, in 2007, this is the way they were treated. Okay. In spite of the Forest Rights Act at that time, 2006, the right, this thing was made. In spite of that, the Orissa government was responsible for that. Okay. But in spite of that, this is the way they were treated. So you can imagine what would happen now. I mean, they're just like, out, you're out. That's it. You know.
Are you in touch with anybody there? Do you know what is the exact situation on the ground now?
I am in touch. So that's what, as I said, the thing, or the capacity of the refinery has been increased. Then all those families who are living on the edges of the refineries, they've all moved out from there, because, you know, they are not able to handle health in every way. And Vedanta is planning to expand its refinery. Now, where do we go and, you know, where do we go and, you know, show our, where do we say, no, don't do it? You know, there are no more such places where one can do it. You know, protest is totally out of the way. One of the reasons why Niyamgiri also got, of course, you know, there are three elements, I think, in this. The struggle is there, the people there who live, they are struggling. Then the executive branch is there, you know, the Supreme Court, the courts are there. And third is the government, which is ruling at that time. I should say, you know, it is on record that Rahul Gandhi went there, and he said that, you know, he protested along with the tribals, the Adivasis in Niyamgiri, and he said, I'm your sepoy, and I will fight for you. I will fight for you. So, So it is an alignment of all these three things. Plus, Niyamgiri got a lot of international coverage. You know, so it was, you know, my first film which I made, it was shown at places where the international audience sort of reacted, and, you know, and they built a pressure on Vedanta, because Vedanta is a UK-based company. Vedanta Sterlite is a UK-based company. So when you get pressure from, the country where you are based, so that makes a lot of difference. But today, I think that all that is out of the window. It's all out of the window. We are just left with the wind. We are holding on to the wind and hoping something will happen. We have nothing else in our hands. And if something happens, I think we should all fall on the ground and say thank you, and say, you know, thank you. That's all that we can say. Yeah.
Which brings me to another point, which is to do with documentary films in general. My film was a documentary, an 18-minute documentary.
Right.
Those days, we had Films Division as a huge distributor of documentary films. And they used to screen it per force in every single theater. Before the main film, you had to screen up.
Absolutely. Everything. Yeah.
Today, what are the kind of channels that you have? I'm not talking about internationally. Nationally, to build up, see, our film Silent Valley was used at the ground level by Kerala Shastra Sahitya Parishad, Silent Valley Committee, to create a ground opinion. You know, so the film played a major role in that. So today, what are the kind of channels that you have to screen your films?
Yeah, the channels, you know, that's a very interesting question, because it's a question which is often asked, you know, how do you reach out to the people?
Yeah.
Now, see, my films are low budget films, and it's not a very high funder film. You know, I just make these films and to send it across. Okay. So my films on agriculture, well, by the way, this film which I put on my YouTube channel, I just put it recently. Earlier, it had got thousands and thousands of views. And then it had also got a lot of dislikes and a lot of comments, which was put out by Vedanta. And it is very clear. And suddenly one day I saw that the film is gone. You know, so this is something which has happened to almost all my films, which is why I decided to have my own YouTube channel. You know, so anyway, how do I see? It depends on the kind of films that I made. Like Niyamgiri, ActionAid, which sort of funded this film, they sort of took it over and they showed it at several places, and then it was shown in Orissa, because there's also the Oriya version also that was Odia version that was also made, so that was shown to that section, and also it had caught on to the people in Orissa. It had really caught on. So it sort of spread like wildfire, because they were feeling the impact of the refinery deep down, the whole district. They were feeling the impact, because these are all agriculture-based communities, right?
Yeah.
So it had this thing. So there was a lot of this thing. So I think political will is a big, huge, we can struggle as much as we can, but political will and political intentions play a big factor in all this.
What is YouTube channel called? I mean, Salt Films.
Suma Josen Salt Films. Yeah. Okay. So that is what it is. Yeah. Uh-huh. So we are in a very, very pathetic state now. So we need to derive strength from each other, energies from each other, to sustain ourselves, and especially because I've always dealt with tragedies of people. Okay, wherever I go, whether it is farmer suicide in Vidarbha or Gujarat riots, which I've covered, the other political films which I've made, and the loss of seeds of the farmers. Loss of land, livelihoods of farmers. So it is always something to do with situations where people are actually losing their lives. You know, as you said, Ganga, very correctly put it, you sort of brush them off. So and today, at this point in history, in our nation, you know, I'm so glad that this film festival is being conducted. You know, and all these traditions are being documented and being shown. It's so important. Yeah.
Interestingly, let me try and end with that kind of a very interesting connection that came to my mind. All your films are about farm, soil, you know, seeds. And Wiley Ka, the organizers is Wiley. So wild in Malayalam actually means farmland. So there is a beautiful connect between Wiley and Kumar's films. Yeah. So do you want to end with, I'm through with my questions and we have touched our 35 minutes. Do you want to say anything about anything?
Nothing much. I think we have covered most of it. Except that there are so many lovely little stories connected to my shoot in Niyamgiri, you know, and these are all such precious moments that, you know, as a filmmaker that you come across. Suddenly you find somebody, you know, who just comes there and he's just sort of, you know, talking away and there you have what you're looking for. You know, it's, and the whole journey of moving around in Niyamgiri was a completely different experience, you know, as it is with all tribal areas. Tribal areas, you are walking into a different terrain, different territory, different kind of people who have so much of an innocence. Of course, now it is might be slightly different, but they maintain that original, you know, original innocence, which is and to imagine that this is going to be lost and this is going to be, you know, which is going to vanish away in a few years. You know, the whole customs, the kind of biodiversity which is there around them, the way they're able to make their handicrafts and the way they're able to their lifestyles. And then, you know, oftentimes people say, oh, those poor tribals, poor Adivasis, you know, no development and so on and so forth. But they're very comfortable and very happy with where they're living. It might not be the best of places, you know, because we had to climb rocks and climb hills. And, you know, I remember the team climbing two small hills and finally we went up a bigger hill. And there was a group of, you know, Adivasis living there. And we were in search of one person who was one of the leaders. And there we took shots of a baby who was just, you know, scrubbed, no soap or anything, just, you know, she ground the haldi, the turmeric, and then she just scrubbed it on the baby and she just poured cold water on the baby. And that was it, you know, that was a bath. So, you know, we took footage of that. And the way of communication with this person whom I wanted to meet and to speak was just yelling. So there was this man who stood there at the bottom and he started yelling, you know, some sound. And suddenly from the forest up high, you know, which you can't even see when you look up, it's just forest, you know, sound comes back. And then he passes on the message that, you know, you're supposed to come down. And then there you slowly see a man coming down. I mean, it's just so incredible. You know, it's so sacred. It's so sacred. The whole thing is, you know, you're walking into a sacred land. This is a land of our forefathers. We have come from that land. And we have distanced ourselves away and we are living in so-called civilizations which have nothing to do with the earth, which have nothing to do with biodiversity, which has nothing to do with water, nothing.
It has everything to do with greed. All that the earth is greed.
Greed, absolutely.
Beautifully is the Adivasis or the tribals, they are actually probably richer than the Adanis and the Ambanis because absolutely. The Adanis and Ambanis will keep, you know, possessing more and more. So somebody very beautifully had said this. The richest person is not the one who has the most. He or she is the person who needs the least.
Absolutely.
And they need the least. They can be happy with whatever little they have.
Right, right, right.
So hats off to the Dongriya, Kuns and all the other tribes. And
right, right.
So let's call it a day. Wishing them more power.
Thank you. Thank you, Ganga, for this. And thank you, Siddharth and the team for giving me this opportunity to show my film and also have this interaction.
And, you're welcome, Suma. We are also thankful. We are grateful that you're here.
Right.
Both of you, we are thankful. From the side of NIFI, I would like to thank both of you for attending to today's Meet the Maker event. And as two friends who have met after like a longish period of dormancy in front of a live audience, I hope you enjoyed the experience.
Absolutely, yes.
Absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. Ganga was able to get the nuances of the film, and I'm glad about it. Yeah.
Okay, so we appreciate your support and efforts in making NIFI what it is, helping us grow, and we hope to see you in some future edition.
Yes.
Okay.
Definitely.
Okay. Okay. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.